Did everyone hear me all right? I want to start off with a question. I want to ask all of you, if when you were a kid, you got asked, what did you want to be when you were? Just raise your hand. Yeah. It's a pretty common question, right? When I was 8, and I got asked that question, I told everyone I was going to be a fireman. Because while I didn't love saving cats and trees, I was kind of obsessed with lighting things on fire. And then a couple years after that, when I got asked that question, I realized I wasn't going to be a fireman. I was going to be a soccer player. But even a few years after that, I realized when my stumpy little legs couldn't even run an 8-minute mile, my soccer career wasn't going to be as successful as I hoped. So before I continue, I have another question for you all. I want you to raise your hand if you've ever asked a kid the question, what did they want to do when they grow up? Yeah. Well, I have news for all of you well-intentioned and curious individuals. That question is terrible. It's true, it's terrible, because most kids have no idea what they want to do when they grow up. And so by asking that question at such a young age, what they want to pursue for the next 50 years of their lives, the results are, at the very least, rocky. When you ask that question to a kid, it suggests that there's one true calling out there for everyone, that there's this Cinderella slipper kind of fit, and that if you just search hard enough, you'll find your calling too. But that doesn't really happen. And in fact, most students who have that vicious search to find their one true calling end up feeling more lost, confused, and indecisive than they were in the first place. The second obstacle to this career search is that the supposed career of one's childhood dreams, that being the answer to the question, what do you want to be when you grow up, hardly ever lives up to one's expectations. Because when you've had this vision of what you've wanted to be since you were a child, you have really high expectations of what that's going to end up looking like. It looks like bliss from a distance, but in reality, all jobs have their own difficulties. Barry Schwartz, a speaker of one of the highest viewed TED Talks of all time, argued that higher expectations lead to higher instances of unhappiness and dissatisfaction. In an analysis of 40 studies that followed college seniors as they were searching for the most ideal job with the best benefits that correlated with what they wanted to do since they were a child, it found that they were often overwhelmed or depressed by the search, and inevitably dissatisfied with the actual outcome. So while it may seem minuscule, a well-intentioned and curious question is leading to generations of entry-level workers who are more unhappy and more dissatisfied with their jobs. I'd also argue that asking kids what they want to be places all of their value in the world on that career. As a school, a community, and a society, we tend to highlight or idolize the future careers or possibilities for the youth. And it feels like because of that, we've completely missed the mark on at least valuing just being a contributing member of a community. We highlight the future lawyers or doctors or whatever's, that it almost seems like you're socially unnoticed to just be a good person. Someone with integrity, or someone with the kind of character to help other people. I argue that this is backwards, but it doesn't have to be. Because no matter what career you choose, the ability to make an impact or help others is universally possible. On average, each person will work about 80,000 hours in their lifetime. You can make that time count no matter what career you choose. That being said, doing good or making an impact is a construct that's really difficult to measure. One movement, known as effective altruism, has tackled this issue by using concrete data to measure how much an individual can actually impact the world. Peter Singer, a philosopher that was known for popularizing the effective altruism movement, likes to raise a certain scenario to this case. Let's say you're walking home to a really fancy party. And you've got on either a nice expensive suit or a really elegant dress. On your way, you see a child drowning in a small, shallow pond. It's you and the child, and it's up to you to save them. Now, I'd probably imagine that every person in this room would save that child without hesitation, albeit ruining an expensive pair of clothes. Peter Singer argues that if you would ruin a couple $1,000s worth of an outfit to save a child, then you could donate or give away a couple thousand dollars that could go to preventing a child from dying from a preventable disease. He argued that these two scenarios were no different. This is a graph, albeit a bit of an outdated one, that marks the global distribution of wealth throughout the world. In 2020, college graduates had an average annual income of $55,000. That already puts them in the top 10% of wealth distributed to the entire world. If 10%, this top 10%, donated a tenth of their income each in 1 year, that would be an excess of $4.4 trillion that could go to anything, to prevent anything or benefit anything in the world. That's just with 1 year. Imagine what you could do with 5 or 10. Now, of course, that stat is idealistic, to say the least. College kids right out of school aren't going to want to donate a tenth of their income. They're going to have student loans to pay for. They need to get a footing in the world. And not everyone donates. That's just the reality. But the potential is there. Despite, and it's completely independent of whatever career you choose. I have one final issue with the question, what do you want to be when you grow up? It's that this question is so focused on what you might do in the future and puts no emphasis on what you could be doing now. Altruism, as it's commonly known, is about giving or providing in some manner or other, like of money. But it's not just about that. It's about helping, contributing. Look no further than the scope of the International School of Florence. Cui Levita, Angelo Del Bello, Marta Capelli, all organizations that actively work to improve the community around them. And better yet, students of all ages can contribute to these organizations that help. Although, it's not just about altruism. Either way, organizations at school are also there. Look at the Tuscan Times, the newspaper. This is a platform that gives students the voice to voice their interests and make great and advocate for change, for positive change in their community. It was an organization built by students, run by students, and continues to highlight the kind of initiative that students and young people can strive for. These are only a few of the many ways that students can help, contribute, or positively impact their community. Asking kids what they want to be reduces the possibilities of what they can do to the world to the simple aspirations of their future career. Instead of asking what kids or students want to be in the future, ask them what kind of person they want to be now. And show them the kind of platforms where they can showcase that person's faith.